Hello everyone, I am Dr. Anjum Rashid. Welcome to my YouTube channel. In this video, I will talk about pediatric Cushing syndrome. Now, what is Cushing syndrome? Cushing syndrome is a state of glucocorticoid excess in which there is loss of normal hypothalamic pituitary adrenal feedback excess. Cushing syndrome is caused by prolonged exposure to excessive glucocorticoids or cortisol, which may be secreted endogenously or administered exogenously. Pediatric Cushing syndrome most commonly results from exogenous administration of steroids. Under normal circumstances, hypothalamic corticotropin releasing hormone, that is CRH, is delivered to the anterior pituitary via portal circulation, and this results in the release of ACTH, that is adrenocorticotropin hormone, from the anterior pituitary into the systemic circulation. Now, ACTH acts on the zona fasciculata of the adrenal cortex to stimulate the release of cortisol, and cortisol causes negative feedback and downregulates the production of ACTH and CRH. Now, in Cushing syndrome, there is loss of this normal hypothalamic pituitary adrenal feedback axis. Now, what are the types of Cushing syndrome in children? Pediatric Cushing syndrome can be divided into two distinct categories. First is the ACTH-dependent Cushing syndrome, and second is the ACTH-independent Cushing syndrome. First is the ACTH-dependent Cushing syndrome. It is caused by exogenous ACTH administration, as in certain seizure disorders. Second is the Cushing disease, which is the ACTH-secreting pituitary adenoma, and it is the most common cause of Cushing syndrome in children who are older than 5 years. Now, third is the ectopic ACTH secretion due to carcinoid tumors of the bronchial or GI tract, pancreatic islet cell tumors, especially in the multiple endocrine neoplasia 1, and also pheochromocytoma and other neuroendocrine tumors. Second category is the ACTH-independent Cushing syndrome. And in this, exogenous corticosteroid administration is the most common cause of Cushing syndrome in children. Second important cause of ACTH-independent Cushing syndrome is adrenocortical tumors, which may be adenoma or carcinoma. Now, these are common in infancy and most are unilateral, and more than 70% of these tumors are malignant. Now, most of these are sporadic but may be a part of genetic syndrome such as Beckwith-Wiedemann syndrome or Li-Fraumeni syndrome. Another cause of ACTH-independent Cushing syndrome is primary pigmented nodular adrenocortical disease. It is associated with atypical or cyclical Cushing syndrome or Carney complex, in which there is skin pigmentary abnormalities, myxomas, endocrine tumors, and schwannomas. Another cause of ACTH-independent Cushing syndrome is massive macronodular adrenal hyperplasia. It is associated with extremely large adrenals and multiple cortisol-producing adenomatous nodules. McCune-Albright syndrome is also a rare cause of ACTH-independent Cushing syndrome. It is a triad of precocious puberty, Kafeolia spores, and polyostotic fibrous dysplasia. Now, what are the signs and symptoms of Cushing syndrome in children? Now, growth failure in association with excessive weight gain occur in 90% of cases. In contrast to adult, children have more generalized obesity rather than centripetal obesity. Now, these children have moon faces with broad cheeks and temporal muscle wasting. And there is also facial plethora. There is supraclavicular fat collection and posterior cervical fat deposition known as dorsal cervical hump. Now, lipomastia is also commonly present. These children have generalized coarsening of the body hair, especially in the endogenous causes. Acne, comedones, and oily skin is present due to hyperandrogenemia. There is thin and fragile skin with poor wound healing. Violaceous stria are present due to rapid weight gain and impaired collagen synthesis. And these are particularly present on the thighs, proximal arms, and abdomen. These children have characteristic myopathy, that is proximal limb weakness. They are unable to comb hair, climb stairs, or get out of the chair and have a positive Gower sign. Glucose tolerance test is abnormal or frank diabetes mellitus may be present. There is hyperinsulinemia and insulin resistance. Now, there may be hypertension and congestive heart failure. gastric irritation, peptic ulcer, and fatty infiltration of the liver may be present. In Cushing syndrome, there is increased risk of severe viral and opportunistic infections. This is due to suppression of innate immunity and T-cell responses. Quiescent TB may be reactivated. Tinea cruris, tinea pedis, and candida albicans infections may occur. Bacterial infections are also common, and viral illness such as varicella may be severe. Now, osteoporosis and spontaneous fractures, especially vertebral crush fractures, may occur. These present with focal pain and tenderness over the midline of spine. Avascular necrosis of the femoral head and slipped upper femoral epiphyses may also occur, and these present with painful limitation of hip movement and a limp. There may be blurred vision due to hyperglycemia and deposition of sorbitol in the lens. There may be posterior subcapsular cataract, especially in the exogenous Cushing syndrome, and this can be examined by slit lamp examination. In Cushing syndrome, there may be sleep disturbances or insomnia. Euphoria, depression, mania, and psychosis may also occur, but these symptoms are more common in adults. In children, obsessive behavior is more common and they seem more studious in school. Now, pseudomotor cerebri, which is benign increase in the intracranial pressure, may also occur in Cushing syndrome. In Cushing syndrome, there may be pigmentation of the scar, skin creases, areola, and genitalia, especially with high ACTH levels. Acanthosis nigricans can also occur in case of insulin resistance. There is thickened coarse skin in the axilla, groins, and around the back of the neck. In Cushing syndrome, there is pubertal delay and arrest in males and females. This is because glucocorticoid excess inhibits gonadotropin release and directly inhibits sex steroid secretion from gonads. Now, males commonly have virilization with increased pubic and axillary hair and phallic enlargement, but there is no testicular enlargement. This indicates that androgens are of adrenal origin. Now, girls may develop premature adrena, hirsutism, especially of male patron, or secondary amenorrhea. Now, how is Cushing syndrome diagnosed? Now, first step in the diagnosis is to establish the presence of Cushing syndrome. For this, three tests can be used. First is midnight cortisol level, which is usually measured in saliva. If it is more than 4.4 microgram per deciliter, it means there is Cushing syndrome. Second test is 24-hour urinary free cortisol, which is increased in the case of Cushing syndrome. Now, normal reference range is usually less than 70 mg per 1.73 meter square per 24 hour. But best is to use the ratio of microgram of cortisol excreted per gram of creatinine, as this ratio is independent of body size and completeness of urine collection. Third test is single dose dexamethasone suppression test. In this, 25 to 30 microgram per kilogram of dexamethasone is given at 11 p.m. and plasma cortisol is measured at 8 a.m. the next morning. If it is more than 5 microgram per deciliter, it means the Cushing syndrome is present. Now, once the diagnosis of Cushing syndrome is made, then second step is to establish the cause. For this, different tests can be used. First is ACTH measurement. If it is less than 10 picogram per milliliter, it is ACTH independent, and if it is more than 20, then it is ACTH dependent. Now, very high level occur in the case of ectopic ACTH secreting tumors. Second test is high dose dexamethasone suppression test. It is used to differentiate Cushing disease, that is pituitary adenoma, from ectopic ACTH secretion. In this, 120 mg per kg of dexamethasone is given at 11 p.m. and the plasma cortisol is measured at 8 a.m. morning before and morning following the dexamethasone. Now, cortisol suppression of more than 50% occur in case of pituitary adenoma. Now, another test to determine the cause is CRH stimulation test. It is used to differentiate Cushing disease from ectopic ACTH secretion or adrenal lesions. In Cushing disease, cortisol increases 20% above the baseline at 30 and 45 minutes, and ACTH increase more than 35% over the basal value at 15 and 30 minutes after CRH administration. While patient with ectopic ACTH secretion, they have a rise in ACTH, but it is less than 35%. Fourth test is two-step dexamethasone suppression test. In this, dexamethasone 30 and 120 microgram per kilogram per day in four divided doses is given on consecutive days. In pituitary Cushing disease, large dose suppress serum level of cortisol, while no cortisol suppression occur in ACTH-independent Cushing syndrome. Now, diagnostic imaging is another important tool in localization of Cushing syndrome. Pituitary MRI with gadolinium contrast may detect adenoma, Adrenal CT scan detect all adrenal tumor more than 1.5 cm in diameter. CT or MRI scan of the neck, chest, abdomen and pelvis can be used to detect ectopic source of ACTH production. Now, octreotide scanning, PET scan or PET CT scan may be used for localization of ectopic ACTH source. Now, another test is bilateral inferior petrosal sinus blood sampling. ACTH is measured before and after CRH administration. It may localize the tumor when the pituitary adenoma is not visualized on imaging. Now, how is Cushing syndrome treated in children? Now, transsphenoidal pituitary microsurgery is the treatment of choice in pituitary microadenoma, that is Cushing disease. Overall success rate is 60-80%. Surgical complications such as diabetes insipidus, SIADH, panhypopituitarism, bleeding and pituitary apoplexis may occur, but it is rare. Relapses are treated with reoperation or pituitary irradiation. For a unilateral adrenal mass, single adrenalectomy has a nearly 100% cure rate and a few require adjunctive chemotherapy. With the bilateral nature of the nodular disease, both adrenal glands may have to be removed to ensure cure. Now, in case of surgical failure or ectopic ACTH secretion without a localized source, some medical options exist. These include ciproheptadine, which is a centrally acting serotonin antagonist, and it blocks ACTH release in case of Cushing disease. Other drugs include metirapone, ketoconazole, aminoglutathimide, and etomidate. These are inhibitors of adrenal steroidogenesis. Mifepristone is a glucocorticoid receptor antagonist. And pasireotide is a somatostatin analog which can inhibit ACTH secretion. However, these drugs are not properly used in children. Now, bilateral adrenalectomy is an option for refractory pituitary adenoma or ectopic ACTH secreting tumor. It is important to note that adrenalectomy may lead to increased ACTH secretion if there is an unresected pituitary adenoma, and this is evidenced by marked hyperpigmentation and is known as Nelson syndrome. Now, patients who undergo adrenalectomy require adequate preoperative and postoperative replacement therapy with the corticosteroids. Tumors that produce corticosteroids usually lead to atrophy of the normal adrenal tissue, and replacement with cortisol is required until there is recovery of the hypothalamic pituitary adrenal axis. Thanks for watching this video. Please like, share, comment, and subscribe to my YouTube channel.